I work for a company called Red Hat, and I'm one of the maintainers of Gluster. So we have an upstream Gluster project, a community project, that provides a file system, and I'm one of the core developers and release maintainers, and anything that pops up is normally where I get involved. I work about 7 years for Red Hat now. I work from Amsterdam, where I live. I have a home office, and I rarely go to Red Hat offices unless there are conferences in the area. So if you have any questions during my talk about the topic, do not hesitate to ask them. I really like you to understand my slides, my discussions, and my explanations. If something is missing or unclear, let me know and I'll answer your question immediately. If the question is a bit more time consuming, I'm happy to talk to you after the presentation. We'll have a break off anyway, so that's really easy to do. During today's talk, I'll give you a little introduction about Gluster. So not everyone might be aware of what Gluster is or how it works, and it's good to have a basic understanding. I'll show you a very brief quick start. I'm not going to give a demo today because the time is a bit short, and I don't think we have enough time to show a demo. If you really want to see a demo, I can probably show you afterwards outside of the talk. I'll explain a bit about what the Gluster community provides on current releases, and which features were added in the different releases that we currently have, and some of the features that are coming in the next releases. So some of the features are really interesting, and I'll, depending on how much time I have, I'll explain them in a bit more detail. So the basics of Gluster. Gluster provides a file system. It is mainly a scale-out file system, meaning that you can add more services or more storage whenever you need, and you can use this storage really as a network file system. So your applications don't need to change. Any applications that use normal local file systems, or for example NFS, they just keep on working. This is a very big advantage for people that move existing applications into the cloud. And not a lot of people are able or can spend time enough to rewrite their storage layers in the applications to, for example, start to use object storage. That's something nice for new developments and new applications, but existing applications are very difficult and time consuming to modify. So Gluster provides a file system layer just with normal POSIX access through Fuse, through NFS. If you really want to, you can use Swift. We have a project called Swift on File, and Swift on File makes it possible to store your objects directly on Gluster without going through the whole OpenStack environment. You can just install only this particular component. We use, for example, or virtual machines use KEMU, and KEMU has a native interface for the Gluster protocol, so you don't even go through the file system itself. KEMU knows how to speak the Gluster protocol and can address virtual machine images directly, which is a huge performance benefit. LibGF API is what the user space library is called, and KEMU uses this user space library to access the Gluster volumes without going through the local file system. The local file system affects performance really a lot. So LibGF API is a library that other projects can use, your own applications could use them, and this makes it possible to skip the whole file system layer. Gluster does not use a metadata server, at least not at the moment. So we don't use a metadata server that is a bottleneck. So most clustered file systems depend on either a single or maybe multiple metadata servers. And if all of your clients need a particular directory, for example, they would all contact this same metadata server, which becomes a bottleneck. So Gluster is developed with and designed with this idea in mind to prevent bottlenecks where possible. It doesn't use a metadata server that all the clients need to connect to. The clients actually are intelligent enough to directly go to the storage servers that contain the data that they need. So reducing bottlenecks is always a good thing. It makes it possible to scale out in a much, much better way. Bluster itself runs on basically any hardware. So at Red Hat, we have customers using the latest and modern HP, Dell, and whatever servers they have available. But at home, I run it on Fedora with 32-bit ARM systems. And for my home usage, which is basically YUM repositories and installation images and whatever, that's perfectly fine. So it runs on very low-end machines until the biggest machines you can imagine. Scaling, I'll explain a bit more about it later. But we scale basically endlessly. You can add servers until your racks are completely full, until your data center fills up. And some of those servers that we have, that customers use, they have like 60 disks per server. Some are moving to 90 disks per server, which is really big. Others use smaller servers, but just many more servers. So whatever you like and whatever your preference is, you can do this. Because we have a very distributed environment, it's very easy to add many more clients. So a client doesn't connect to a single server, a client connects to the server that contains the data. That makes scaling the number of clients really easy, because the clients get distributed over all of those many servers. A bit about the terminology that we use in Gluster. The basic storage unit in Gluster is called a brick. So a storage unit is this, in this case, it's a file system mounted somewhere on your storage server. So you format a disk or a RAID device as XFS, mount it on the storage server, and you call this part a brick. It's just a directory where you want to store your files. Gluster has a very modular approach on the functionality it offers, and it's a very layered model. Each layer is called a translator. So we have a translator for locking, a translator for caching, a translator for access control lists. There is a translator that does local access, converts local access to a network protocol, and another translator that converts the network protocol into local function calls back. Everything that we do, everything that we implement is a translator, and by enabling or disabling certain translators or restructuring the order, you can add functionality or remove it if you don't need it. So in the previous slide we had bricks, and bricks is one brick is a storage unit, but a client uses a so-called cluster volume. A cluster volume consists out of many bricks, and depending on how you structure your stack of translators, this volume has certain properties. So if you want to enable POSIX access control list, for example, the translator will handle these particular calls. If you do not enable it, the translator will not get loaded and you don't really need anything. So you can just skip it and you can enhance performance, well, a little bit, you don't really notice it. So the volume describes the whole layout. It includes the features that a client needs to enable, and it also includes all of the bricks that participate in the volume, including the replication or distribution, basically any feature that Gluster would offer. In Gluster, it's a clustered environment, but we don't call it a Gluster cluster. A Gluster cluster speaks really awkward, and we prefer to call it a trusted storage pool. A trusted storage pool consists out of many servers. These servers are normally called nodes. We call them nodes or peers. We don't really like to see them called servers, Because if a user says that their server doesn't work, we don't really know if it is a client system or if it's a system that actually functions as a storage unit or a storage node. So we prefer, for example, peer and client devices. Is it so far clear what I'm talking about? Understandable? Yeah. Now, I mentioned that Gluster is able to scale up. The difference between scale up and scale out is listed in this diagram. For example, if you have a very big server, say you have a big server, the server can contain maybe like 90 disks, but you want to start small. So you only fill it up with maybe 30 disks, one third of the availability. Then once you grow, you can say, well, we just add more disks. This is the scale up, the vertical line. Adding more disks or adding more RAM, adding more CPUs in your existing server is the scale up approach. This works fine also with Gluster, but it's not very practical. And most of the times you actually bought the hardware, for example, the huge server is more expensive, and you're only using it for maybe one third if you only use a third of the disks. So that's not really a way that we advise you to use Gluster. We prefer to use it in a scale-out sense. That means you have a server, maybe a bit smaller server, not one with 90 disks, but you have a server that addresses your current needs. With this server, you start to scale out, which means you just buy another server when you run out of space, add the server to your trusted storage pool, increase the size of your volume by using the other server, and this is how scale-out works. It makes it more flexible. It also addresses an improved distributing of the data, but also of the clients. So if you have one huge server and all of those clients would connect to this particular server, or maybe two servers, then the bandwidth of the server gets really important. If you have four servers, but only half the size, then all of those clients connect to four servers at the same time. That means you have twice the bandwidth of only two servers. And that can be quite an important way of distributing the load. So depending on how many clients you have, depending on the available bandwidth that a client requires, and so on, it might be really, really useful or most advisable to increase the number of servers. If you're running in a cloud environment, you just add more virtual machines, and that's way more efficient, and you're much more flexible than doing the scale-up approach, where you just add more disks to a machine, and more disks, and more disks, and that's not too efficient. So I'll go a bit into the basic functionality for distributing data. In this diagram we have two servers. We have server 1 and server 2, and we use the file name to select a server that contains this particular file. So this is only distribution, there's no duplication of data, there's no replication. So if one server fails, the contents of this server is not available. So what we do is we take the file name, for example file 1, assume that file 1 is the file name, and the client, the mount point, which is most often a fuse mount point, but it can also be an NFS server or the Samba server, which acts as a Gluster client. This client calculates a hash based on the file name, and the client knows, okay, well, the first half of the hash range belongs to brick number 1, the second half of the hash range belongs to brick number 2. So if we calculate the hash and the hash falls in the first half of the whole range, then we place the file on server number 1. If the hash of the file name results in server number 2, for example with file number 3, then the client places the file on brick number 2. So this is done for creating files, but as an application or as a user, you normally open a file by file name. So on the client side, You know the file name, you know which file you want to open. So what the client side does is it hashes the file name. It says, okay, well, I'm going to read this file name, file number one. File number one, if we take the hash, it says, well, it falls in the first half of the whole hash range, meaning that we need to go to brick number one. And the client actually knows, without any real difficulty, which server contains the file. So this is the whole trick with distributing files. And it's actually pretty straightforward. There are some twists and knobs. For example, if you have a file called README, you don't want all your files called README on the same server. So there is a twist in the algorithm that uses the depth of the directory and things like that. So it actually moves the files, for example, file README in the root directory, and file README in the subdirectory will be moved to a different brick, and so on. And it rotates a bit. But this is the whole principle of distributing something. You take a hash, in this case, of something you know, the file name. You hash it to some value. The hash function is known, so it always hashes to the same result. And the client should know the hash ranges for this brick and the hash range for the other brick. And with that, it always knows which server contains the file and knows which server to contact when it wants to create or wants to read the file. Is this clear? Yeah? No. If we're doing without any distribution, we do replication. Replication is just like mirroring files. So when a client creates a file and writes some contents to it, it actually sends the write to both servers at the same time. So this is not a very efficient use of network bandwidth, but it is very safe because the client actually knows which server accepted the data and which server didn't. So the client is in charge of the replication algorithm. And remember that the client can be, for example, an NFS server or Samba server. So if you have an NFS client that is more or less located here, then the NFS client writes once to the cluster client, don't read the mount point, but to the cluster client, and the cluster client, NFS Ganesha or cluster NFS, would then do the write to both of the bricks at the same time, verifies that the data is there, and says, okay, well, you've written the data, so you can move on to the next step of your application. So this is even much simpler than the distribution logic, at least the basic overview. Any questions so far? Yeah. Now, because Cluster uses translators, this layered approach of functionality, you can combine the distribution and the replication. So what you do is you create a distributed replicated volume by combining these translators. It's just a different command line to create the volume. So you don't really need to be worried about it. It's just some internals that I'm explaining now. But you have these translators, and if you want to write a file to a distributed replicated volume, the client knows which subvolume, which replicated volume 0 or replicated volume 1 has a certain hash range. So the client takes the hash range or the hash of file number one. This hashes to the first half of the whole range that there is. Then the client knows, well, I have to write the file to replicated volume 0. Okay. The next step in the translator layer is the replicated volume 0 is actually a replicated volume. So instead of writing it to one brick, we have to write it to two bricks. And the client just says, okay, well, we have brick one and brick two that needs to contain file one. So the clients, the same as before, decided, well, we're going to write it to the first half of the hash range, the servers that are responsible for this. But we have to write it to both servers at the same time. And then the file gets located on two bricks at the same time in a distributed fashion. The next time we write file number two, the hash of file name number two results in a hash which is part of the second half of the whole hash range, meaning that it's part of the second brick set, the deprecated volume one. Deprecated volume one is again a replicated volume, and the file needs to be written twice. So both server 3 and server 4 will get the file written immediately by the client. Does it make sense? Yeah, it's almost time for a coffee, so don't worry too much. If you have any further questions on how this works or not, don't hesitate to ask me afterwards too. Now, I already mentioned that Gluster is a mount point, so you can use normal applications, and you mount them with fuse a user space binary executable that actually does all the work for you. We provide NFS. There's Gluster NFS, which supports NFS version 3, and NFS Kanisha, which is the newer NFS server that we want to use. NFS Kanisha is much more full-featured. It supports NFS version 4, it supports PNFS, and a lot of other fancy things. Samba is another way to access a cluster volume. Many environments use Windows. I've not used Windows systems for years, but still a lot of companies seem to do so, and they would like to use Samba to access the data, which is fine. So we provide a very good Samba integration. There's a team working within Red Hat, mostly dedicating on making sure that Samba and Gluster work really nicely together. We have a Gluster for OpenStack. There are several components in OpenStack that work directly with Gluster, including the Swiftful File project to make sure that you can access your objects over S3 that are located on Gluster. I think Cinder and Glance also support the direct Gluster. So most of the integration with, for example, Samba, NFS Kanisha, they all use libgf API. There is a Python bindings, there are Java bindings, I think there are even Ruby bindings and PHP bindings someone created. But most of the current applications that use libgf API use the C library directly. So Kemu is one example. Beros is a backup software. It's a fork of Bakula. So one of the Bakula developers started Beros as another project, and they integrate very well with Gluster. So you can create backups directly on Gluster volumes without mounting a Gluster volume, but you can also backup your Gluster volumes to somewhere else, for example, on tape. So Beros is quite an interesting project, and even though your Gluster volumes can be pretty big, tape storage is still used a lot. So Beros can be used to backup your whole Gluster volumes on tape if you like to. Now, we provide packages for different distributions. So Fedora, Debian, NetBSD are regularly updated. NetBSD is most of the times the fastest in building new versions of packages. After that, Fedora and Debian stays a bit more behind. The CentOS storage stack provides packages for CentOS or RHEL, and most of the packages are either available from the repositories directly or from download.cluster.org, where we also provide repositories that people can use. So creating and using a volume is like 7 steps. So, but I'll skip it a bit, because it's taking a bit more time. We provide 3 different releases. So 3.7 is the current release, and we do monthly updates. 3.6 and 3.5 also get regular updates, but there's not always a bug to fix every month, so they don't always receive an update. But 3.7 is currently well maintained, and 3.7.10 was released earlier this morning. So we're building packages, and they should land in the repositories probably over the weekend. This is a list of features that we already added in the 3.5 lifetime, which is a nice list. It's the most important features. We don't really need to care too much about it because 3.5 is released maybe 2 years ago. 3.6 added yet another list of features, a little bit more features than we got added with 3.5. 3.7 adds yet more features, more complex features. For example, bitrot is a very interesting feature to detect if your stored files actually are kept the same way as is. So hard disks tend to fail, or, well, they don't always return the same data as you've written. So especially with the bigger drives, this happens more often. So if you have a 4 terabyte drive, after a while, you might read a little bit different data than that you've written. So like bit flips happen. To detect these, we have bitrot, we have bitrot detection, so that we can actually identify if the data is still correct or not. And if it's not correct, we'll just complain very loudly and say, well, you really want to check out this drive and possibly replace it in the near future. So the last points, arbiter volumes and sharding were added to improve performance in virtual machine workloads. So instead of having one huge virtual machine image, we enable sharding. Sharding says, well, we can use megabyte sized images. So 4 megabytes is the default size, I think. Depending on your usage, you might want to have shards up to 512 megabytes. And that really performs quite well. So we have a lot of advantages in the distribution, so that each shard gets distributed to other servers, whereas one huge big VM image would be placed on one particular server. So if you're unlucky and the file names hash to the same value, that means that all of your VM images would be accessed on the same server, which is a bit unfortunate. But if you only have 2 servers, then there might be some unequalness or imbalance. And with sharding, the distribution is much more equal. Not only for access, but also for space usage, it's much more efficient. So if you have many big files, then you can run out of space on a particular brick. But with shards, because the files get split in many pieces, the bricks fill up in a much more equal way. Arbiter volumes is a special way of three-way replicas, which prevents split brains. So if you have a two-way replica, a file can get into a split brain. And that's an issue because Gluster cannot tell which file is the correct one. That's something the system administrator needs to decide. With a three-way replica, we can identify, well, we have 2 good copies and we have 1 bad copy. But it costs 3 times the space, so it's not very efficient. With an arbiter volume, we fake a 3rd copy. So we have 2 real copies of the data and a 3rd empty file. But we can use this empty file to see if which other of the 2 bricks has the actual real correct data. So we prevent split brains with an artificial empty 3rd file that keeps track of which file was updated and which not.
So it's not a simulation of the right file.
No, so it does all the looking and everything on the 3rd file too, but it doesn't write data to the file. So it's really just an empty file, but it is used to calculate which other files, in case there was a network outage or something, which of the other real copies is out of sync. So yeah, it's easier to detect failures. And well, to prevent system intervention or system admin intervention this way. So we don't like system admin intervention because anything someone needs to do is a burden. So it's a task someone needs to look into. So I mentioned bitrot already. this is a bit more about sharding. NFS Kinesia is the new NFS server, so this is something if you are interested in Cluster and you need NFS, then NFS Kinesia will replace Cluster NFS in the, well, maybe not so short or not near-term future, but it is on our plans to replace Cluster NFS, the old NFS server, with the newer full-featured NFS Kinesia. NFS Kinesia is a project started by CEA, it's a French atomic agency, and they got help from IBM, and IBM even produced SONAS and a NAS environment with NFS Kinesia. So we're now starting to use NFS Kinesia in Cluster as well. 3.8 is around the corner, hopefully. So I'm one of the main release maintainers for 3.8, and I hope to release the first beta by the end of this month, so the end of April. Hopefully we have most of the features feature complete and we get it included in a new branch and get the first beta packages out. What we do is we improve tiering a lot. There will be a REST API to manage Cluster. So at the moment we have the Cluster command line and it can output XML, but it's not very friendly for applications to use. So we have a REST API that actually allows you to create volumes and to peer probe other Cluster servers and so on. There is a tool called Hecate, which is intended to be integrated for OpenStack management and other management interfaces. It's a single point management infrastructure that can manage many Cluster environments. And some of the more minor features that are given. Georeplication is an async way of replicating data on Cluster. The previous replication that I've explained in the diagram is synchronously, which is basically in for the same data center. If you have multiple data centers spread around the world, then you probably want to use georeplication for these. Georeplication is asynchronously, it has a master site and a slave site, and maybe more slave sites. And this makes it possible to have complete disaster recovery. If your one data center completely fails, you can just jump to another data center and all your data is still there. So the new tiering feature that we added in 3.7 and sharding are now also supported with 3.8. Policy-based split-brain resolution is probably something if someone run into split-brains with Cluster, we now have policy split-brain resolution, which says you can automatically resolve split-brains based on certain policies. For example, the latest policy that is being added now at the moment is based on the M time of a file. So we say, well, if you want to resolve split-brains automatically, the highest M time, modification time of a file, that is the correct file. So there are others like based on the file size or based on a certain brick. So you can tell, well, we had a network outage, the bricks could not communicate with each other. We know that this side of the network is correct. So everything on this side is the correct data and everything else is stale and old. So we make sure that resolve the split brains with only the data and move them to the other side. So using split brain resolution is really very helpful. Some of the features that we'll add is experimental, but you will get to see more in them in the release, that's when we do the release. Some preparations for other functionalities, so Samba and NFS are the main access protocols that we use, but they don't really cooperate to each other because they have different semantics for accesses. What we want in the end is that Windows clients and Unix-like clients can access the same volume without conflicting logs, without any access control list issues, and everything should be the same on one or the other protocol. So this is a lot of work, And there's no open source project that actually supports this yet. NetApp has something like it, but doesn't support all of the functionality that we would like to support. So this is a huge work in progress. 4.0 is coming as well. Hopefully later this year. December is the current time that we would like to see it released. We're not sure yet if we can make that. So we want to scale out more and more. I'll just skip these. These are some of the resources. So if you have any questions about Cluster itself, you can email the Cluster users list. We have the Cluster developers list. So if you want your application to use SnipGF API, don't hesitate to contact us on the Cluster dev list, where we can answer your questions and can maybe help you out with your application. If your application is open source, that would really benefit, because then we can just work together. If you have a closed source application, it's a little bit more difficult. We are also available on IRC, on Freenode in the Hashcluster and the Hashcluster dev channel, our website, documentation, and we have a lot of projects in our Cluster ecosystem under the Cluster organization in GitHub. And that's it.